Thank you and welcome to our podcast, My Personal Library. I am Pragna Talikoti, a filmmaker by profession, and I'm going to read and share my personal thoughts on some of my favorite stories from various books, authors, genres, etc. And a small disclaimer, rights of these stories are with their respective publishers or authors. This podcast is produced by Pixels Unlimited and narrated by me, that is Pragna Talikoti. Today I'm going to read a short story written by O. Henry, The Cactus. William Sidney Porter, better known by his pen name O. Henry, was an American short story writer. Henry was a master of surprise endings who wrote about the life of ordinary people in New York City. A twist of plot, which turns on an ironic or coincidental circumstance, is typical of O. Henry's stories. Some of O. Henry's works include The Gift of Maggie, The Duplicity of Hargreaves, and Ransom of Red Chief. His legacy includes the O. Henry Award, an annual prize awarded to outstanding short stories. The Cactus. The most notable thing about time is that it is so purely relative. A large amount of reminiscence is by a common consent, considered to the drowning man. And it is not past belief that one may review an entire courtship while removing one's gloves. That is what Trysdale was doing, standing by a table in his bachelor's apartments. On the table stood a singular-looking green plant in a red earthen jar. The plant was one of the species of cacti and was provided with long, tentacular leaves that perpetually swayed with slightest breeze with a peculiar beckoning motion. Trysdale's friend, the brother of the bride, stood at the sideboard complaining at being allowed to drink alone. Both men were in evening dress. White favors like stars upon their coats shone through the gloom of the apartment. As he slowly unbuttoned his gloves, there passed through Trysdale's mind a swift, scarifying retrospect of last few hours. It seemed that in his nostrils was still the scent of the flowers that had been banged in odorous masses about the church, and in his ears a low-pitched hum of 1,000 well-bred voices, the rustle of the crisp garments, and most insistently recurring the drawling words of minister, irrevocably binding her to another. From this last hopeless point of view, he still strove, as if it had been habit of his mind, to reach some conjecture as to why and how he had lost her. Shaken rudely by uncompromising fact, he had suddenly found himself confronted by a thing he had never before faced, his own innermost, unmitigated, arid, unbedecked self. He saw all the garbs of pretense and egoism that he had worn, now turned to rags of folly. He shuddered at the thought that to others before now, the garments of soul must have appeared sorry and threadbare. Vanity and conceit? These were the joints in his armor. And how free from either she had always been. But why? As she had slowly moved up the aisle towards the altar, he had felt an unworthy, sullen exultation that had served to support him. He had told himself that her paleness was from thoughts of another than the man to whom she was about to give herself. But even that poor consolation had been wrenched from him. For when he saw that swift, limpid, upward look that she gave the man when he took her hand, he knew himself to be forgotten. Once that same look had been raised to him, and he had gauged its meaning. Indeed, his conceit had crumbled. Its last prop was gone. Why had it ended thus? There had been no quarrel between them. Nothing. For the 1,000th time, he remarshaled in his mind the events of those last few days, before the tide had so suddenly turned. She had always insisted upon placing him upon a pedestal, and he had accepted her homage with royal grandeur. It had been a very sweet incense that she had burned before him. So modest, he told himself. So childlike and worshipful. And he would once have sworn so sincere. She had invested him with an supernatural number of high attributes and excellencies and talents, and he had absorbed the ebullition as a desert drinks the rain, that can coax from it no promise of blossom or fruit. As Trysdale grimly wrenched apart the seam of his last glove, the crowning instance of his fatuous and tardily mourned egoism came vividly back to him. The scene was the night when he had asked her to come upon his pedestal with him and share his greatness. He could not, now for the pain of it, allow his mind to dwell upon the memory of her convincing beauty that night, the careless wave of her hair, the tenderness and the virginal charm of her looks and words. But they had been enough. They had brought him to speak. During their conversation, she had said, "Captain Carruthers, tell me that you speak the Spanish language like native? Why have you hidden this accomplishment from me? Is there anything you do not know?" Now, Carruthers was an idiot. No doubt, Drysdale had been guilty. He sometimes did such things, of airing at the club some old canting Castilian proverb dug from the hodgepodge at back of the dictionaries. Carruthers, who was one of his incontinent admirers, was the very man to have magnified this exhibition of doubtful erudition. But alas, the incense of her admiration had been so sweet and flattering, he allowed the imputation to pass without denial, without protest. He allowed her to twine about his brow the spurious bay of Spanish scholarship. He let it graze his conquering head, and among its soft convulsions, he did not feel the prick of the thorn that was to pierce him later. How glad, how shy, how tremulous she was. How she fluttered like a snared bird when he laid his mightiness at her feet. He could have sworn, and he could swear now, that unmistakable consent was in her eyes. But coyly she would give him no direct answer. "I will send you my answer tomorrow," she said. And he, the indulgent, confident victor, smilingly granted the delay. The next day, he waited impatient in his room for the word. At noon, her groom came to the door and left the strange cactus in the red earthen jar. There was no note, no message, merely a tag upon the plant bearing a barbarous foreign or botanical name. He waited until the night, but her answer did not come. His large pride and hurt vanity kept him from seeking her. 2 evenings later, they met at the dinner. Their greetings were conventional, but she looked at him breathless, wondering, eager. He was courteous, adamant, waiting for explanation. With womanly swiftness, she took her cue from his manner and turned to snow and ice. Thus and wider from this on, they had drifted apart. Where was his fault? Who had been to blame? Humbled now, he sought the answer amid the ruins of his self-conceit. Voice of the other man in the room, querulously intruding upon his thoughts, arose him. "I say, Trisdale, what's the deuce is the matter with you? You look unhappy as if yourself had been married instead of having acted merely as an accomplice. Look at me, another accessory, come 2,000 miles on a garlicky, cockroachy banana steamer all the way from South America to convive at the sacrifice. Please to observe how lightly my guilt rests upon my shoulders. Only little sister, I had to, and now she's gone. Come now, take something to ease your conscience." "I don't drink just now, thanks," said Trisdale. "Your brandy," resumed the other, coming over and joining him, "is abominable. Run down to see me sometime at Punta Redonda and try some of our stuff that old Garcia smuggles in. It's worth the trip. Hello, here's an old acquaintance. Wherever did you rake up the cactus, Trisdale?"
"A present," said the Trisdale, "from a friend. Know the species?"
"Very well. It's a tropical concern. See hundreds of them around Punta every day. Here's the name on this tag tied to it. Know any Spanish, Trisdale?"
"No," said the Trisdale with a bitter wrath of smile. "Is it Spanish?"
"Yes. The natives imagine the leaves are reaching out and beckoning to you. They call it by this name, Ventomam. Name means in English, come and take me."
Author O. Henry's ability to convey such powerful emotions without straying into the realm of sappy sentimentalism is noteworthy. This story shows, regardless of our motivation, there does seem to be this intrinsic desire in human nature to adopt a different persona when placed in a social situation, especially when it comes to dating. As Shakespeare famously said, "All the world's a stage and all the men and women are merely players." The cactus can be seen as a cautionary tale pertaining to consequences when people are not honest with themselves or others, resulting in a missed opportunity of finding love. O. Henry hammers this point home with a sharp, ironic ending that is achingly poignant.
I am Pranya Tarikoti. You are listening to My Personal Library, the podcast.
You can subscribe, rate and review on Podbean, Stitcher, Spotify or wherever you get the podcast. To know more, please follow Pixels Unlimited on Instagram, Facebook and YouTube. Thank you for your time. Keep on listening.